In Sarah on Radio Lab, we're talking about the relationship, sometimes the uneasy relationship between the brain and the body.
I think most people who have brains, that would include, I think, most of the listeners here, think the relationship between brain and body is more like the relationship of a commander to a commandee.
Right. The brain makes the orders.
And the body responds. But I think the more accurate way is to think of this as a conversation between the brain and the body.
How do you mean?
Well, because any movement, even a very basic one, let's just say wagging my tongue. Blah, 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 blah.
Okay.
Very simple, really, but it still involves three steps. First, the brain has to issue the command.
Tongue station, this is mission control, commence wagging.
Second, the command must be executed. Blah, 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 blah. And third, now this is the crucial step. The tongue, in this case, reports back to the brain.
Mission control, we have wagging. I repeat, we have wagging.
Thereby completing the loop.
Mission control, the foot.
Mission control, this is foot.
Give me your coordinates, over.
Roger that, mission control.
Now, this happens, this conversation you're hearing right now.
Niner Alpha.
It happens constantly. All over your body, your brain is issuing command.
Left knee, turn left knee.
Parts of your body are receiving the command.
Which is left knee.
And reporting back.
Right leg standing by.
And this conversation adds up to something really quite important. It adds up to a sense of yourself.
It's an unconscious sense which really allows you to move normally.
That's Oliver Sacks again, the neurologist we talked to at the start of the program. You have, of course, a sense of smell and of touch and of taste. He says this sixth sense also has a name.
It's sometimes called proprioception.
Proprioception.
Proprioception is the unconscious sense by which the position of one's limbs, the posture of one's body, is automatically monitored. In a slight way, for example, if you go to the dentist and sometimes half of your mouth or your tongue is numbed, the tongue may feel very large. You may grab the dental mirror to reassure yourself that all is okay. And this does and it doesn't reassure you.
But you can still wag your tongue. Your brain is still sending messages to the tongue.
Tongue station, this is mission control.
But the tongue isn't sending messages back anymore. You can't feel anything. You know that feeling?
Yeah, of course.
Now, could you imagine that instead of just losing your tongue not responding, suppose your whole body doesn't respond? What would that be like?
I mean, we have words like deaf or blind. We don't have a word for being, in effect, deaf and blind to one's own body.
Thank you.
knew what proprioception did and what the effects of the loss of proprioception would be until Ian.
And when they first met, Dr. Cole said to him,
he said, how do you manage?
How do you cope with this?
Unbelievably, he was the first doctor to ask that question.
Ian told him that on his own, over the 12 years, he had figured out how to walk again and how to grasp a cup again, and explained that he did this by carefully breaking down and then reassembling every single move he made. It started this way.
I was laying in bed one day in hospital, and I wanted to sit up, and it just wouldn't happen. And then laying there in frustration, I just thought the whole process through, and I broke it down into quite simple, small movements. And I lay flat, I checked where absolutely everything was before I started, and then I then started with the head and folded and tucked my chin onto my chest as if to start the first part of the curl. Then I moved my arms slightly forward, and I started to tighten some muscles in my tummy and around my back. And then I started to curl myself to sit in an upright position. And when I got there, I said, damn, do you fuck, and we fell out of bed.
Studied movement in a way no one in history has ever studied before. No ballet dancer, no professor of neurology has ever had to study movement the way Ian does every day.
Because every day, every move that Ian makes, he has to consciously direct. It's as though Ian were two people, a puppeteer and a puppet. His mind is directing and his body is obeying. And the strings of Ian's puppet are his eyes.
My eyes. I control all my movement with my sight.
Because he doesn't have this feedback information coming from his limbs back to his brain.
The proprioceptive feedback.
Because that's missing. Unless he looks directly at the limb he wants to move, he can't move it.
If I look away from my hand, I lose all connection with it.
Well, what happens if it's dark, if the lights are out?
Well, you know, he can't afford darkness. If the lights go out accidentally...
That's quite a dangerous place to be. I fall over.
He has not turned out the lights in the night in the last decades.
Them now occasionally, and I still don't like the little devils. You know, I mean,
when you're manipulating the paperclip, what are you actually trying to figure out? How
sorry,
much
he
pressure to put on
the word he's, but he's.
I lost my earphones.
So if you could repeat that.
Oh, okay.
You should do Jessica.
Is the headphones back on yet?
Hang on, I'll do it. Okay. My job.
By the way, is he able to put on? I mean, is this? You can tell me what's going on, but is he able to grab the headphones?
He can answer.
I can grab the headphones and put them on, but because putting the headphones over the top of my head, I can't see exactly where the headphones are in relation to the rest of me. Although I would finally get there. It's a lot quicker if Jonathan just puts them on. Right. And he likes to feel
good. So what I was asking was, what were you doing with the paper clips all that time?
I was giving paper clips as an exercise to get my fingers to move again and to threadle them together and then to unclip them. A very, very frustrating therapy, but one has to admit that it is a good one, in that it takes an awful lot of fine dexterous movement to get paper clips together and apart again.
Sub-moves and then relearning everything, it's exhausting.
Very, very mentally tiring.
Because it takes such total concentration.
What if you were walking down the street and suddenly a thought, like a daydream, pops into
your head? Jonathan has a very good memory of that, and maybe that would be good to come from Jonathan.
Ian and I were walking through Oxford having done some groundbreaking experiment or whatever, and Ian suddenly stumbled, and I'd never seen him stumble ever before, and he was looking at a pretty girl, and his thoughts had drifted from walking and from the concrete ahead of him to what he'd like to do to this girl.
Well, she was about 18, she had nut brown hair, lovely legs and miniskirt, and it was a navy blue dress with white polka dots.
This is a family program.
but you see, when Ian walks anyway, he has to think the whole time about walking and the floor.
So merely the erotic sort of charge cost you your ability to walk?
Well, be it that sort of charge, but any distraction really took me away from my focus, which is where is my left foot in relation to my right foot, and where am I balanced at the moment, and how am I actually going through this process, at what stage am I in this movement? And to suddenly be detracted by that, by a waft of perfume and a pretty girl, took all that concentration away. It can be taken away by the song of a bird or the sound of music drifting from somewhere. Just on that day, was it pretty?
Thank you.
solved this problem as best you can? I mean, do you feel like you're one person, or do you feel cut in half, like a mind directing a body, like maybe two people?
I don't think about it in the way that you just related there. I just think about, I want to get up, I want a cup of tea, and this is the process that I have to apply to do that.
Yep, that's what we all do. I don't think stories like this involve heroes, they involve people who try their best under certain circumstances.